You know, Steve asked when he invited me to come. He said the reason he would invited me to come was because of the connection I had with the Catholic worker before. And it was slight, but important. I think when anybody goes through a conversion, the first reaction is always move with the poor. And then they start to discover what their vocation is all about. And there was one incident I want to share with you. When I was in a seminary, on our days off, I went to Maryknoll. And Maryknoll is 40 miles outside of New York City. And I'd take a day off and I'd go down to the Catholic worker with Dorothy Day. And I was a deacon at the time. And there's one incident that stands out. It was a cold day in middle of winter, and I was dressed to do some work, so I was dressed in my old clothes, and I was about 6 months away from ordination, which is important because when I walked into the door, at the front of the door was one of the men, the volunteers from the street, that was sitting at the front desk, and he took a look at me, and he said, "Hey, bud," he said, "that door swings both ways." And my mouth dropped open, and I stood there, and I wasn't ready to give a response, and I backed out the door. And while I was standing outside, one of the men was outside and saw what happened. And he came walking up to me and he said, "Do you need a meal?" He said, "You want my ticket?" And he gave me, he was offering me his ticket. He said, "Hey, come on." He said, "You want a drink?" He said, and he opened his coat, had a bottle. And I was staring at him. He said, "Come on." He said, "Come on, I'll show you how to get warm." And we walked down the street, and there was a barrel. You know, one group of men was standing around this barrel, and they had the bonfire in the middle of the barrel. And so I went and shared some heat with the men. But it was an enlightening moment, you know, to see the love that these men had for each other. And you could see why Dorothy Day all of a sudden had this great love for the poor, and why God says that the poor are beloved, and that's sort of where all of this comes from. Because I want to talk to you about peace, the peace that Merton has, and because it's very similar to the peace that Dorothy Day has, that Mother Teresa has, that Catherine Doherty has. These are very unusual people. And it's not a peace that's a lack of war. You know, we had a period, you know, right between 1989 and 9/11, when all of a sudden there was some peace in the world. And I think some of you are that old where you remember that stage where all of a sudden this whole pall lifted, especially right after 1989. And when the whole Cold War stopped, but there was a great peace during that period. And but that's not the peace we're talking about. Because the peace that Merton had, and the peace that these people have, is something totally different. And that's what I want to try to share with you. To see if I can develop this. Because it's part of this Christian life. It's part of meeting Jesus. It's part of the development of the whole prayer life. I was with the Dalai Lama a couple of weeks ago for 4 days. And it was in Bloomington. And he gave us a series talks on enlightenment and how he comes to enlightenment. And the Dalai Lama has something. You know, I gave a talk with him about 3-4 years ago. And, you know, some of us, when you develop a talk, you want to have something profound to say that's going to really astound people. And you develop this talk and you give it, and then all of a sudden the Dalai Lama gets up and he says, "Hey, God is love," and people are astounded. You know, and same thing happens with Mother Teresa. She'll throw out a comment, and, "Wow, do you know what Mother Teresa just said?" Everybody says it. But when Mother Teresa says it, or the Dalai Lama says it, or Dorothy Day says it, or Thomas Merton says it, it's different. It's different. These people are electric, you know. They have something inside, and it comes out of their life with God. And it's something that all of us should taste. All of us should taste. You know, when he was talking about the war, there was a period in his life, and he was talking about the journals. He wrote a letter to somebody. I don't know who he wrote the letter to, but I just want to share a piece of it, because in the letter he said, "If a pacifist is one who believes that all war is always wrong and always has been wrong, then I'm not a pacifist." He said, "I do believe it's an avoidable tragedy." He continued with a quote from Kennedy. President Kennedy at the time said that if we do not end war, war will end us. And further, that the human race is like an alcoholic who knows that drink will destroy him and yet always has good reasons why he must continue drinking. Such a man is in a fatal addiction to war. He's not really capable of seeing a constructive alternative to war. And if the task of building a peaceful world is the most important task of our time, it's also the most difficult. It will in fact require far more discipline, more sacrifice, more planning, more thought, more cooperation, more courage than war ever demands. The task of ending war is in fact the greatest challenge to human heroism and intelligence. These people, like Mother Teresa, like Merton, like Dorothy Day, are people who could walk the street without fear, who have peace in their heart. No matter what's happening outside here, they're always people of peace, because they're living in a different world. They're living in a different interior world because they've been touched by God, and they have a different worldview. And I'd like to try to describe it to you, because it's really a progress in the spiritual life. There's progress in a prayer life, because all of these people, you know, I spent a lot of time in Madonna House, which is comparable to the Catholic worker in Canada, and before I entered the monastery, Catherine Doherty invited me to come up. And I spent 8 months with her. And every afternoon she'd come down after lunch and she'd give a talk. And the people would be mesmerized by this woman's talk. And she was she died about 1983. And I was there in 1978. And but we'd sit there and listen. And she'd say, "Last night I had a dream. Now this is what my dream was all about." And you know, we'd be listening to something that anybody else would say you'd be bored sick. But this was Catherine Doherty. And you'd sit there, you know, they're working on her canonization right now. And you wanted to listen to any word that came out of her mouth. Well, what I'd like to talk to you about is what happens inside. Who are they? There's two aspects I'm going to try to describe to you. One is, they live in the world of God. That might sound simple to you, but most of us don't take God serious. I'm talking about everybody, you know, because we have our own personal mission. But to take God serious, to take God serious like a St. Paul or a John the Evangelist or somebody who wrote the gospel, is to live for God and find out really who God is and how He penetrates my life. Who Jesus is. If Jesus hasn't touched the center of your life and you don't think about Him all day long, then you don't know who He is. These people know who God is. They know that when they came into this world, they're going to be here forever. When I talk about the world of God in their mind, something happens in the course of your spiritual life. That all of a sudden you walk in through a particular door and a light shines on, and everything changes. Everything changes because all of a sudden you realize, my gosh, God controls my whole life. You know, like St. Paul talks about, in Him I live and move and have my being. You know, that comes out of a certain sense of God that nobody else has. This man had, St. Paul I'm talking about, had one experience. One experience, and all of a sudden it changed his life, and he went out and changed the world. When he was on the way to Damascus, he's knocked off his horse, and he finds out, my God, this is Jesus, and Jesus is still alive. And he had to tell the whole world about that. You know? That's what I'm talking about. Something happens inside a person's mind, inside a person's inner world. He's living from that moment on as if God is sitting right here and He says, this is my house. I sent you into this world. With the day you were conceived, I gave you a mission. And I'm living in you with you every day, every moment of your day. And that's what these men lived like, you know. That's what these people, like Mother Teresa, the peace she has in her life is because she lives with God. You know, she could walk through the streets of Calcutta and everybody else would be terrified. But when she walks in Calcutta and to pick up the dead, she could intimidate anybody that comes along the street to come after her. Because she knows what her mission is all about. And she's fearless. And that's what Merton is all about too. You know, because when the Berrigans came down to visit him, and when Joan Baez came down to visit him, they didn't come down because they were looking for insights. They came down because they wanted to feel this electricity that was going on in him. The electricity that was of the peace, you know. This is in the every morning when you go to Mass and you turn to the person next to you and say, the peace of God be with you. That's the peace we're trying to give it to each other. It's the peace of Jesus. It's the peace of God. That's one piece of it. He lives in the world of God. The other piece that comes out of this is what it means in terms of time. Because at some point in your spiritual life, you realize, I'm here forever. I'm here forever. And what it means is, when I was conceived, when the egg and the sperm met in my mother's womb, I was here forever. God created me for eternity. And what it says about this is there's only one reality. The reality is heaven. And if we're here for heaven, then that's a pattern of my life, you know? I'm trying to tell you how we describe what Jesus did, because the only way we can describe it is if you really know what happened to Adam and Eve and what we lost. Because when Adam and Eve were standing in the garden with God, they were in this wonderful intimacy with God, where they loved each other, you know? They had this enormous respect for each other because they knew what it was to be a human being. They knew what it was to be totally dependent on God. And then all of a sudden they renounced it, and Satan comes up and says, you know something? You know what God is trying to stop with you? He says, he doesn't want you to see the way he sees, because he sees good and evil, and you don't see that. And he was right. And what happened, as soon as they disobeyed, they had different eyes. They moved into a different world. They moved out of the garden by themselves, but they didn't have to be cast out because they no longer saw. And then Jesus comes along 2,000 years ago, and he forgave us our sin. And you know what that means? Is that I could see again. I could see with different eyes. I could hear with different ears. And if you open up the gospel and read the gospel, you'll see that's what it says. They're always have all these miracles about the eyes and the ears and a new way of seeing things, you know. And that's what happens to some people who take God serious. Is all of a sudden they see and they hear differently and they walk in a different world. And they know that from the moment they come into this existence, they're in heaven and they're on the way and they're preparing themselves and they're purifying themselves for that moment when they make the transition. And that's who Merton was. And that's the peace that he enjoyed. And it's the peace of God. And I share this with you because this is open to everybody in here. And the only thing you have to do to get it is spend some time in silence. Spend some time in solitude and ask, because God is your Father. And he's going to give you anything you want. And the biggest thing anybody should desire is to have my eye open. The longest journey in the spiritual life is from the head down to the heart. To get out of the theory, to get out of the point of thinking, hey, what this is all about, and finding out how it affects your whole life, and to live in this thing. And create this whole world, because what made him so effective was this whole sense of the world of God. And when he came and touched them, you know, somehow God came through. And that's why when you pick up a book by Merton, no matter what the book is, there's something electric about the sentence, about anything that comes off the page, because he lives in that world. And, but that's how to bring it down to a nutshell for. I wish I could talk this out in discussion with you because it's so important for your spiritual life. You know, Merton would not be Merton without Gethsemani. He'd just be another author. And Gethsemani would just be a group of buildings without Jesus. And the heart of Merton is Jesus. And if you read Merton for the sake of Merton, he'd be insulted. He'd be insulted. Because he knows that the whole purpose for his life was Jesus. And that's where he got his whole life. That's why you have to, what you have to look for in Merton is for the heart of Jesus. I think that's good enough for tonight because I'm beyond my bedtime.